morning. May it please the court, Anup Prasad, appearing on behalf of the petitioner, Mr. Yasar Saeed. Mr. Saeed's life and mental health took a rapid downturn after his mother's suicide. In spite of this downturn, the immigration judge found that he warranted relief from removal. In overturning, the board committed several legal errors when analyzing Mr. Saeed's arrests and speech. First, without explanation, the board ignored its own precedent for analyzing contacts with law enforcement, not resulting in a final conviction. The board's precedent, Thomas, requires careful, individualized analysis of a contact before deciding if any negative discretionary weight can be attached. A number of factors must be considered, including whether or not charges were filed, if they were filed, the stage which proceedings progressed, the underlying conduct that's alleged, and the person's culpability. Simply, under Thomas, it's not permissible to just tally up the number of entries on a rap sheet and assign negative discretionary weight based on that. But that's exactly what the board did here. In a single sentence of reasoning, it notes Mr. Seeds had numerous contacts with law enforcement and then attaches significant negative discretionary weight without considering any of the Thomas factors and without engaging any other analysis.
The board did separate out arrests, though, and treated them only as arrests, right? And acknowledged they were just arrests?
Yes, it did separate convictions from arrests. Our issue is with whether or not it did the proper analysis of the arrests.
But where does Thomas say that you need to do more than acknowledging the difference and separating them out? I mean, is there like an actual requirement of the number of words you have to give about each of them? I'm not sure why you think that they didn't actually give indication that they did consider the difference.
I don't think you're required of a certain number of words, but Thomas does lay out that it has to be an individualized analysis of each contact. It can't just be generally you've been stopped by police 20 times and therefore you're guilty 20 times. You have to consider what the person's alleged to have done, whether or not they were actually guilty of it, if they were actually charged, where they found, you know, to.
He recites all, and it does separate them out. Thomas says basically you're supposed to look at the nature of the contacts and the stage to which they progressed. And he did that and then makes a judgment based on all of that. Because it is a cult. In the end, it's not that he's making a judgment on each one, it's making a collective judgment, isn't he?
Well, I think you need to analyze each one and then assign collective negative discretionary weight.
They analyze. It seems like you're asking us to basically say that he needs to write more words as to each one.
I think they need to.
That basically it.
I think they need to list what factors are considering for which contacts. Now, if the board had done the analysis that we're asking it had done, and I think the immigration judge did this, it would have found three things. First, it would have found that the majority of the contacts they're calling numerous were actually for traffic violations or failure to pay auto registration. And one of the factors in Thomas is to consider the underlying conduct. There's no indication when they say numerous contacts that they consider that. Second, Mr. Saeed credibly testified for some of the contacts that he was actually innocent of any wrongdoing, was not charged or convicted. Under the board's own precedent, should not be given negative discretionary weight. There's no indication in the board's decision that they consider that. Finally, they would have found that in the decade prior to the onset of Mr. Saeed's schizophrenia, he had had no criminal convictions. So I think there are serious issues with the summary nature in which the board did their analysis. The second issue is that the board considered Mr. Saeed's lawful, constitutionally protected speech as a negative discretionary factor.
Why do you say this is protected speech?
So it's well settled that immigrants who live in the United States for decades like Mr. Saeed are protected by the First Amendment. Now, the government's only argument here is that his speech is a true threat, right? But it's based on a factual record that does not exist here. The uncontested factual findings here are that Mr. Saeed exchanged fictional stories with his cellmate.
Don't we have case law, though, from our court that says that false statements about terrorism that cause harm are not protected speech? And isn't that exactly what this was? Even if he didn't intend to do it, he was talking about terrorism. His cellmate went out and caused harm based on these statements. Why don't we have exactly unprotected speech given those circumstances?
I think the case you're referring to is the one the government refers to, which is the United States versus Kaiser. And so that case involved a man who had mailed sugar packets labeled anthrax to various businesses. In that case, the district court found, based on the defendant's own testimony, that he had the subjective intent to make a threat. The factual findings here from the immigration judge are the exact opposite, that his intent was to tell a fictional story, that he had no intent to engage in terrorism, plan terrorism, and no ties to terrorist organizations.
Yasar has a whole section on false and misleading information, and I don't know that the intent really matters for that. This is false information that causes harm, and why doesn't that fall under Yasar?
Well, I think this court's rulings in Cassell and Bagdasarian require subjective intent to make a threat. And in Cassell, he was found to have that subjective intent because I think he testified, I wanted people
well,
to...
Well, okay, that's true. But to be convicted of a crime for making a threat, you maybe need to have the intent. That's a criminal issue. But you're talking about this being protected speech. No one's putting him in prison for this speech, but why is it protected speech if it's false speech about terrorism that causes harm? I thought our court had said that's not protected speech.
Well, Your Honor, I think the true threats analysis is the same if it's in the criminal context or it's another government sanction on the speech. But
isn't the true threat from the point of view of the listener? I mean, we get the intent, I think. The intent component comes from criminal statutes needing intent.
Well, I think there are two separate prongs under this court's true threats jurisprudence. There's a subjective intent requirement on behalf of the speaker, and then also an objective person hearing the statement in context must have reasonably understood it to be a threat. There's also no evidence in the record here.
You're saying he must, both of those have to be
said. Both of those need to be said.
He must mean it to be a real threat.
You're right, intended to be a threat.
What is the case you're relying on for the notion that it needs to be intended to be a threat for it to, even under this Yasar line of cases about false statements that cause harm?
I think there are two cases. There's Cassell and Bagdasarian, both of which were cited in my opening brief.
I guess falsely shouting fire in a crowded theater is not, couldn't be counted because he knew it, the person who knew the theater was
well,
fire.
I think two points on that. One is Mr. Saeed only communicated these statements to his cellmate in the context of exchanging a story. I think we'd be looking at a different situation if he had mailed letters to various, you know, government offices like the person in Yasar saying, I'm planning to engage in terrorism. The second issue here is Mr. Saeed's...
But why can't the agency say, whether, you know, the IJ said he didn't intend to engage in terrorism, fine. But why isn't someone who tells such realistic stories that they inspire other people to go commit terrorism someone we don't want in the country? I'm not sure why the agency can't do that. What's protected about that speech?
So, false statements don't lack First Amendment protection. That's what this court held in United States versus Alvarez, and the Supreme Court upheld.
But Alvarez talked about false speech that causes harm is different than just false speech and can be not protected. So, isn't that what we have here?
Well, I think they found that Mr. Alvarez's statements did cause harm, but that wasn't enough to take it out of First Amendment protection.
Well, if you wanted to step back in terms of how you analyze this First Amendment claim within an immigration claim, I think we'd ask you to be prepared to discuss Reno.
Right.
So if before you get to the immigration claim, you go back to the situation that the proceeding here is a cancellation of removal proceeding, correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
So we've indicated that in that regard, there's no protected liberty interest in cancellation of removal, correct?
I don't think there's a protected liberty interest in being granted cancellation.
Okay, so so that's our foundation, and now we have to build on that to say, so what does that mean if you don't have a protected liberty interest in the cancellation of removal? How then does that intersect with adding now a First Amendment claim on that in light of Reno?
So, I think we need to take a look at this court's decision in Yepes Prado and also the Supreme Court's decision in Kent versus Dulles. And so what that held is that the board's authority is limited. It doesn't just have limitless discretion to consider anything at once. The discretion
is
limited.
Both of those, the consideration was some kind of constitutionally protected right. So don't we have the same prior question we were talking about before about whether it's protected speech in the first place? Do you agree that we don't even get to those cases unless this is protected speech?
Right. So I think it's a three-step analysis. First, does it implicate a constitutional right? And so in the context of speech, you start
with... Would you start with the fundamental proposition that there's no protectable right with the cancellation? And my question, which I don't think I have an answer to, is how does that intersect with this First Amendment claim? I think you started to cite all these cases, which kind of take it off on a different tangent. I think you have to first get past that hurdle, then you have to get past Reno. And so I need to understand how you would do that.
I think the issue is over the scope of the board's authority. And so what Yepes Prado and Kent held are that administrative agencies can't consider conduct that implicated a constitutional right without express congressional authorization. Now, on Reno, Reno was at its core a jurisdictional case. The holding in Reno was that a challenge to removal proceedings, including a first amendment challenge, could be brought, but needed to be brought on a petition for review of final removal order. And that's what Mr. Saeed did here. Now, in Section 3 of Reno, they do discuss the First Amendment analysis, but that issue is not before the court. Cert was not granted on it. It was never briefed. It was never argued. And as Judge Souter's dissent notes, that section should be read as dicta. Even if it's not dicta, the analysis in there is extremely specific to a selective enforcement First Amendment claim. And that's not the claim that is being brought here.
But the opposite of a selective enforcement claim here, right? Because selective enforcement is when you think the agency is doing something it's not admitting. And here, your challenge is to what the agency admitted, right? And it feels to me like it's the flip of that. Would you agree with that?
In some ways.
Because what you're saying is the agency said they were basing this on his speech, and we think that's improper. Whereas Reno is about we want to inquire into whether the agency really had a motivation that it didn't admit.
Right. The agency was clear that they were considering Mr. Saeed's speech as a negative factor. And so, under the first prong of analysis, starting at the premise that all speech is protected by the First Amendment, we determine it falls into one of the exceptions to the First Amendment. So that's obscenity, true threats, fighting words, perjury, fraud. And if it doesn't, then we proceed to the second step and determine if Congress has explicitly authorized the board to consider the speech. There's no statute. That's not what the government argued here, but again, I think it's a question of intent, and that's really the critical issue here is what was Mr. Saeed's intent?
You know, I find it difficult, even stepping away from parsing the case, to read the FBI, you know, report, which says what Saeed did was to send, ask the other guy to do specific things connected with terrorism, and the notion that somehow says that he thinks he knows that Mr. Saeed is denying he meant it. It was only a joke, but he says, I don't think that's right. Now, I'm an IJ, and I've shown this report. Am I to disregard it?
No, and the immigration judge did consider the FBI report. He explicitly states he did in his decision. He also considered Mr. Saeed's explanation, and he weighed these two pieces of evidence and credited Mr. Saeed's explanation over the FBI report's conjecture. And so, placing all the things that the FBI report said Mr. Saeed said in the context of a fictional story.
So his finding of fact is that it was said in jest or something.
I think Mr. Saeed used the phrase tall tales. The immigration judge says boasting, but it was a fictional story. The judge finds that very clearly on 88, 91, and 94 administrative record.
Do you want to reserve your remaining?
Yes, Your Honor. Thank you.
May it please the court, Daniel Samuel on behalf of the attorney general.
It's funny, you lawyers. BIA lawyers,
we do.
I have the same
name. I'd like to think we're
going to last case.
Your Honors, the court is without jurisdiction to review this discretionary denial of cancellation of removal. The INA is clearest to that point, and Congress, of course, enacting the INA was clearest to that point. Of course, there is a jurisdictional carve out, a narrow one for constitutional claims and questions of law, but none of Mr. Saeed's claims fall within that category.
It seems like a question of law, whether the agency considered a factor that it can't consider. He's saying this was protected speech, the agency considered it, and it can't be considered. Why isn't that a question of law?
It's not a question of law because, it is a First Amendment claim is a constitutional question without question. Right? But the court's jurisprudence is such that it has to be a colorable constitutional claim. And this falls outside of that. Your Honors, there was some discussion earlier we cited in our
brief. But that makes sense. Are you going to say it's not colorable because this isn't really protected speech?
Yes.
So what difference does it make if we say we don't have jurisdiction because this isn't colorable because it's not protected speech, or we say we have jurisdiction but this claim fails because this isn't protected speech. I'm not sure why you care about this difference.
I appreciate your points, and it is somewhat semantic. Should the court find jurisdiction in that it pierces that veil and gets into that narrow jurisdictional carve-out, then we, of course, ask the court rather than to dismiss.
Like most lawyers, you don't care which one you win on so long as you win on one of them.
I am unremarkable in that respect, yes, Your Honor.
Why wouldn't we have jurisdiction? Because if you make a colorable claim that there was First Amendment is implicated in the decision, in order to figure out whether there is a true First Amendment claim, if it's not a frivolous claim, why isn't it colorable that we should at least go and figure out what kind of claim is it under the First Amendment? So why wouldn't we have jurisdiction? Let's just say we decided to go down Chapter B.
Understood.
Now we have jurisdiction, and apparently you don't care if we go A or B, depending on the outcome. So now we're on Path B, and we say we have jurisdiction because he says, look, you took this into account. Now you have, is it colorable speech, or is there anything in Reno that would suggest that we have yet another hurdle that he has to jump through? So if you could address it down those lines, would it be helpful?
There are several hurdles, Your Honor. To begin with the court's order last week in Reno, the Supreme Court was rather clear. When an alien's continuing presence in this country is in violation of the immigration laws, and there is no dispute as to that, Mr. Saeed has never disputed his removability from the United States, the Supreme Court now continues, the government does not offend the Constitution by deporting him for the additional reason that it believes him to be a member of an organization that supports terrorist activity. And that is what occurred here. Now, to read the board's decision in full and in context, the board denies cancellation of removal as a matter of discretion because of its criminal history, focusing on the four convictions and then parsing out the arrests and noting that under this court's precedent that's permissible. And that alone suffices from the board's perspective to deny cancellation of removal. They then continue. Furthermore, and that's when they get into his claims of terrorist activity. And the board does, the IJ did say he did not intend it. The board goes right to his character. Okay, says this is bad character. And in, I think it's a 1992 case, Wisconsin versus Mitchell, the Supreme Court, in the context of a criminal prosecution, not somebody such as Mr. Saeed, who is seeking government largesse, but the prosecution of a United States citizen, holds that the First Amendment does not prohibit the evidential use of speech to establish the elements of a crime or to prove motive or intent. And here the board used it just to show this is additional evidence of Mr. Saeed's bad character. So,
do you think that the board meant there that he had the intent to commit terrorism and so was disagreeing with the IJ on that?
I don't think so. The board's decision to me reads the other way. It's essentially, regardless of whether he intended to do it, in the FBI letterhead memorandum says, we cannot rule out the possibility, which again, there is no finding of intent here other than the immigration judge plainly found there was no intent. But the board's decision taken in context is regardless of intent, the fact that he had plans to, and developed highly detailed plans to bomb a federal building in Sacramento, and explain precisely how he would intend to do it to avoid detection, is evidence of bad character.
So it's whether it's a tall tale or not,
that's
you're
correct.
Saying that if you read the furthermore paragraph of the opinion,
yes,
then you get into the character issue.
That's precisely it. It went to bad character.
It seems like the government's brief, and I can't remember whether you're the author of the government's brief, talked about Saeed's terrorism planning and other terms that sounded like the brief was assuming that he had this intent, which I thought was somewhat inconsistent. I mean, I actually read it the way you just said, but what you're saying now seems inconsistent with the brief.
I'm not sure it's inconsistent at all, Your Honor. I mean, what we did in the briefing is emphasize, I think, that there was speech, and regardless of whether it's intended to, I mean, there was significant detail, as the FBI letterhead memorandum points out, and we did rely heavily on that to explain the context of the board's decision.
But it seems like the IJ thought this wasn't really terrorism planning. This was telling stories. And then your brief point, it talks about terrorism planning. So you're not saying that you meant to be saying it. You're saying at this point anyway that it's not your position that this depends at all on a finding that he really intended to plan terrorism.
That's correct, Your Honor. An apologist's brief did not make that clear. But the board's decision says regardless of whether there is intent, intent doesn't matter. It doesn't matter under Kaiser. And it's not protected speech under Kaiser. And to the extent it was found to be protected speech under Wisconsin versus Mitchell because the board used it for, I'm sorry, Judge. Under Wisconsin versus Mitchell because the board used it as evidence of bad character. And that was a permissible use, assuming that it was, in fact, protected speech. Now, briefly, Your Honor, there was some discussion as to arrests versus convictions in the briefing. Again, this is a discretionary determination, but the board followed its own precedent. And to clarify, the appropriate precedent is not a matter of Thomas, which is a voluntary departure case. It is a matter of CVT, which this court cited approvingly in Redor. And in fact, CVT makes plain that the IJ should avoid what they call cross-pollination between the various types of relief when exercising their discretion. So my point in saying all this is that CVT, which the board and the IJ relied upon, was the correct precedent to follow, and not a matter of Thomas. If there are no further questions, again, coming back to whether it's a jurisdictional issue or not, I'd ask the court to either dismiss the petition for lack of jurisdiction or as a discretionary denial, or deny on the merits.
So if we thought this was protected speech,
yes.
Is it your position that Congress delegated authority to consider protected speech?
Yes, Your Honor. I'm not sure Congress has delegated it so much as it is permissible for the board to have done so under Wisconsin versus Mitchell.
But what about under the Yepes, Prado, and Kent? Don't we need a congressional delegation? If this is protected speech, which you're not arguing it is,
yes.
But if it is, then don't we need congressional delegation to the board to consider that? I don't see in this statute even something that sounds all that discretionary.
I think that Congress has delegated to the board pretty much unfettered discretion.
So what language would you point to in the statute to support the idea that Congress delegated authority to consider it protected speech?
I believe the statutory language, and I apologize, I don't have that statute in front of me, says the Attorney General. Now, of course, the Secretary of Homeland Security may grant cancellation of removal.
So it's the
you made that as the unfettered
discretion. Yes.
But there are some cases to that effect.
Yes, Your Honor, there are. And that's the delegation. And because, again, assuming this is protected speech, that the board used it, and the decision is clear, it used it as additional evidence of bad character. That was a permissible use of that speech, assuming that it was, in fact, protected.
If it was protected, I guess that's kind of the beginning of the inquiry and not the end of it. That is to say, there's lots of protected speech that can have just dreadful consequences. So the person who's saying it, even though it's protected speech.
Yes.
So, I suppose the easy way to deal with this case, easy for us, it would be to say, okay, this whole thing about protected speech, it seems not to be really terribly important of what was going on here.
Yes.
And it was just treated that way, treated as being not tall tales, is what we call them, right?
Yes.
So let's send it back down and say, look, just leave that out and decide this case again without getting into what he said that you think is interpretive, which you didn't believe any of.
Your Honor, under the futility doctrine, there would be no reason to do so because the board's decision is plain that it went, it decided it on criminal history. Okay, page 4 of the administrative record, continuing to page 5. However, notwithstanding the favorable considerations present, we conclude that the respondent's extensive criminal history militates against the favorable exercise of discretion in this matter.
That's an interesting conversation. It's kind of doesn't matter because
yes.
The board didn't consider it one way or the other.
So it considered it as additional evidence.
Of course, they decide.
Yes.
In any event,
So the furthermore, right. We should read the furthermore as in the alternative or something. We already have
the alternative. We have this. It is a criminal
not
history.
But in addition.
Yes, we're going on criminal history alone. Additionally, we find this, regardless of whether he intended to commit this terrorist activity, as an evidence of bad character. If there are no further questions, Your Honors, I would submit on the brief and ask the court to either petition on the merits or dismiss for lack of jurisdiction. Thank you, Your Honors.
Thank you.
So the government makes a number of arguments today that are not made in its brief, including the cite to the Wisconsin case and also the argument that the board, in fact, didn't consider his speech. It would ask those arguments to be considered waived. There's no disagreement about Mr. Saeed's intent. It was not to make a threat.
You mean we can't affirm or dismiss or whatever we're supposed to do unless the argument itself, not the issue, but the argument was made?
Well, I would ask that the court not consider the argument or deem it to be waived. But I think it's clear from the decision that the board did consider Mr. Saeed's speech. There's an entire paragraph dedicated to it. It's not, we can't simply amend the decision by erasing it. Now, the board doesn't have limitless authority to consider good moral character. It can't take constitutionally protected activity and just rebrand it as evidence of poor moral character. That's what the board tried doing in Yepes Prado, and this court rejected. They claimed that his decision to have children out of wedlock was evidence of good moral character, and this court said that's not constitutionally permissible. It's the same here. You cannot just take any activity, including a person's faith or political activity, and say it's evidence of poor moral character.
They were members of the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine. So they, even though in that case there was a clear First Amendment problem, the Supreme Court held that that it was appropriate for them to do it. Why isn't this case different but less offensive to the First Amendment than Reno was?
Well, Your Honor, fictional speech is protected by the First Amendment. A short story by Kafka or Poe might be disconcerting, but it's still protected speech under the First Amendment. There's no distinction to be made between high-value speech that's political or not political.
Would Salas be a member of the Popular Front espousing views of the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine? I couldn't agree with you more, but that if Kafka were here, he could say anything he wanted. That doesn't mean he couldn't be deported for being a Czech
if they were going to consider his speech, there needed to be congressional authorization. There's no statute in the Immigration Act that authorizes the board to consider disconcerting speech. That's an extremely, extremely large grab of power that the board's doing here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you both for your argument this morning. Saeed versus Lynch is submitted.